Hey, what's up everybody? Today we're going to be doing a deep dive into the Shadow Library documents in the Cindered Shadows DLC pack. I'm going to go over when you can unlock it, where to find the quest, and break down each document one by one. Like basically all of my videos, this video is going to contain major story spoilers, so if you don't want to hear it, go ahead and play the game. Also, make sure you give this video a like and hit that subscribe button to support the channel. Now, let's jump right in. If you haven't heard already, once you beat the Cindered Shadows DLC, you'll have the ability to unlock the Shadow Library. The series of events for unlocking it is as follows. You have to beat the DLC storyline, wait until chapter 13 of the main storyline to unlock it. During the main storyline, talk to the influencer located in Abyss and use 2,000 points to unlock Organize the Shadow Library. Once that is completed, head up to the courtyard area next to the dining hall and you'll see a suspicious looking woman who will want to give you a quest. Then head back down into the abyss, into the Shadow Library, and there you will find a list of rare books. When you pick up this item, it will automatically unlock the banned text from the Church of Seros. Now let's go through them one by one. The first text is titled, Letter to a Mysterious Noble. My beloved, you are right. It seems he would not hesitate to divide the house. What's more, I hear he's considering taking his hold of the territory and joining the kingdom. I can't believe he would even consider dragging another region into this, not to mention stirring up trouble over his inheritance. At a time when the Alliance desperately needs to unite, he's clearly out of his mind. Though he bears a major crest and you a minor crest, your father was wise in his attempt to declare you his heir. As it were, I can't help but wonder what your intentions are with me. I'm drowning in letters proposing marriage to that beast. He may share your face, but the resemblance ends there. I refuse to marry such a foul creature. If you don't come to me soon, I'm going to you. Don't forget that my father's blessing could be revoked at any moment. I will depart Deirdre at the end of the lone moon. You had better be prepared for my arrival. I wish to marry you beneath the garland moon. Why? Well, I'm a woman after all, and even I harbor dreams of being a garland bride. Understood? Great. Make it so. Claudia, second daughter of House Regan. Obviously, the person they're talking about is named right there, Claudia, the second daughter of the House Regan. But what you might not know is Claudia is a distant relative of both Claude, named after Claudia, and Judith, the hero of Daphnol. But let me give you some backstory on what this letter is referring to. House Daphnol, which was founded by the hero Daphnol of the Ten Elites, was originally part of the Lester Alliance. It held a prominent position as one of the five great lords that controlled the Alliance. According to the documents in the Monastery Library, the house was divided due to a feud and split in two, with one side staying in the Alliance but losing prominence, and the other founding House Galatea and moving to the Holy Kingdom of Fargus. This document describes the inheritance feud between the two brothers of Daphnol, which led to the split. The son with the minor crest was chosen to inherit the house, and this infuriated the son with the major crest, which eventually led to splitting the territories. Claudia was being pestered to marry the son with the major crest and refused because she wanted to marry his brother. All in all, this basically describes what led to the split of House Daphnol and some interesting tidbits of Claude's descendant's personality. The second text is titled An Antiquated Note. A scrap of paper is stuck between the pages of a book, and it appears incredibly old. Moose meat. Albinian moose is preferable. If unavailable, beef or horse meat may be substituted, though the dish's unique flavor will be somewhat altered. Goddess Messenger. Be sure to skin, gut, and clean the fish before use. Xanadu Treasure Fruit. While difficult to obtain, it's well worth the effort. If necessary, boa fruit may be substituted. Seasoning and spices. Adrestian rock salt, herbs of Fargus, and honey of Lesser are strongly recommended. This is a special dish prepared for the new emperor at ceremonies. Though its ingredients are extremely rare, making it rather expensive, chefs must refrain themselves from sneaking bites during preparation. What this note is referring to is a recipe for the late game dish you can prepare in the dining hall called the Best of Fodlan. I figure the devs put this in here for people that might be unaware that it even exists. Or maybe it's to encourage people to try and make it. Either way, these are the ingredients in case you are wondering. I might make a video showing off how to make it if you guys drop it in the comments. The third document is called The Feast of Decadence, the seventh song. Banquet celebrating the marriage of the young Emperor Lycaon III continued until the full moon waned to half moon. The waitstaff scurried about the castle refilling golden glasses. All present savored the fine Baracus from Boromus, as well as the screams of the northern swordsmen as they were torn apart by wild beasts during the... The countless dishes on the banquet tables were overflowing with spectacular offerings. Treats themed after the four saints graced massive platters, just waiting for our greedy fingers to snatch them up. In honor of Saint Keyhole, guardian of the land, prime Gronder wheat was used to bake endless loaves of delectable bread. In honor of Saint Sethlene, savory fish was presented, a dish she is believed to have loved. When the clown dressed as Saint Saros decapitated the criminal dressed as Nemesis with a single swing, the spectators cheered with unbridled enthusiasm. A young man, staring at Emperor Wilhelm as he caught the saint and pulled her into a close embrace, suddenly beckoned me. He pressed his lips to my ear and whispered sweet nothings, mirroring Emperor Wilhelm and Saint Saros upon the stage. The date of removal and set of signature follow. It appears to be a novel set in the Adrestian Empire. It has sustained great damage, so nothing else is legible. Okay, let's start with the easiest option. This is fiction. This is something akin to an opera. It was made for pure entertainment. Obviously, Wilhelm was not around when Saros killed Nemesis as his own son was fighting the war then. Wilhelm was dead as a doornail. Or we can look at the fact that the descendants of the House Resfelg have the crest of Saros, and instead of it being given to them, they got it from Saros smooching all over Wilhelm. However, due to their hair color, I would say this is completely unlikely. So let's just call it fiction for now. Also, they mention that this document appears to be a novel set and by definition is fiction. The fourth document is titled Words of Love. Table of Contents. How to Compliment a Lover. The Art of Seduction. The Myth of True Love's Singularity. Gifting Saint Sethlene's Love Garland. Alone Time and Greeting the Dawn. The Date of Removal and Seth's Signature follow. It seems this was briefly part of the monastery's library, but all pages are missing save the table of contents. Now, for some juicy speculation. This document is obviously related to Saint Sethlene. The Garland Moon is something that Claudia mentioned earlier in the first document, and during the Garland Moon transition in the game, they explain that women pick white roses, weave them into a garland, and give them to close friends or potential lovers. It is safe to assume that they are talking about Saint Sethlene's love garland. And during Claude's support, we learn that she is a low-key freak, trying to find books on things that young people do, namely romance, which is this game's way of saying hot, sexy time. But I do wonder if she was looking for this book specifically. I mean, she was obviously associated with love and sex if they wrote an entire book on it and had a whole ritual dedicated to her. So they were most likely emulating something she used to do with her suitors. Either way, Flayne is a freak in the sheets, and we all know it now. The fifth text is titled, Burnt Remnants of a Report. Burnt papers that resemble a report of some sort. Few passages survive the fire and are still legible. Item 18, Part 5. The Fargus Rebellion. I harbor doubts about the army Luke has raised. How did he recruit soldiers without raising suspicion in the Empire? How did he acquire those mysterious weapons, so like heroes' relics? What is the true identity of Pan, the tactician rumored to have been integral to Lug's victories, and those who slither in the dark? Item 22, Part 2. The Shadowed Order of the Knights of Saros believe that King Klaus I of Fargus was assassinated. Everyone believes that his will, which demands the territory be divided among the three princes and fails to name a successor, is fake. This purpose was likely to involve the Leicester region and display a greater military force than the Empire. Item 49, Part 18. The Tragedy of Dusker. After which more members of the Western Church are strongly criticizing the Central Church, Among them are those who claim the incident in Dusker was the work of the Shadowed Order of the Knights of Saros. It seems a confrontation over the dogma's legitimacy is inevitable. Soon, the child of House Gaspard, Item 51, Part 6. Son of the Alliance's leader, Duke Oswald Regan, has died in an accident. This follows an accident involving the previous successor, and even the Knights of Saros suspect it was at Count Gloucester's command, though it seems too conspicuous. There is some concern that this could spark a war. With Duke Regan gravely ill, the situation is... So, the weird thing about this report is that it extends over 400 years from Imperial Year 747, the time of the Fargus Rebellion, to Imperial Year 1179, which is around the time of Godfrey's death. Godfrey was the son of Leicester Alliance leader Duke Oswald Regan and uncle to Claude. I believe this is a report of the suspected misdeeds of the Agarthans and those who slither in the dark. I mean, this report reveals a bunch of crazy stuff if it's true. It tells us, at the very least, that those who slither in the dark have been causing a great deal of turmoil throughout the region pretty much since forever. If you don't know what I'm talking about, take a look at my two-part series where I discussed everything we know about them so far. Not only did they cause the fracturing of the Empire with the Fargus Rebellion, the army Luke raised mentioned in the document is the Agarthan army. That is why they didn't raise any suspicions amongst the Empire, because no one even knew they existed. And the mysterious weapons they were mentioning were Agarthan technology similar to the Heroes Relics replicas we have seen throughout the game. Pan, if you don't know, was an advisor to Lug, the King of Lions. This document implies that Pan was really those who slither in the dark, which means they caused the first break from the Empire. This also means that Edelgard was wrong again and it wasn't Rhea's doing at all. The second part of the report looks like it's describing a failed attempt at those who slither in the dark to further fracture the region by assassinating Claus the First and then forging a will that divides Fargus and incites the Alliance. Okay, the third part of this report details the tragedy of Dusker, which we already knew was caused by those who slither in the dark. This document simply describes how the son of House Gaspard, Christoph, and apparently the Central Church, were tricked into thinking that this was some sort of a plot by the Knights of Saros. The last entry details Godfrey's death, which implies that Count Gloucester ordered the killing, but it seems too obvious. Since the last three entries were tied to those who slither in the dark, it is safe to assume that they either killed Godfrey themselves, or at the very least schemed their way to getting it done via Count Gloucester. Well, that'll do it for part one. Anyways, thanks for watching, everyone. I hope this helps provide some context to the documents in the Shadow Library. I also hope this helps you think about the overall big picture of the game and what the lore actually means. So tell me what you guys think. If you guys have any questions or anything to add, let me know down in the comments. I hope everyone enjoyed it, and if you did, give this video a like, and as always, don't forget to hit the subscribe button for more dope content. Peace out, everyone.